Chris Cuomo and Allison Camerota.
All right, welcome to our viewers in the United States and around the world. This is your new day. It's Thursday, March 22nd, 6 o'clock here in New York. Allison is out on assignment. Erica Hill joins me, and what a week of news we're dealing with here. Here's our starting line. We begin with a CNN exclusive. Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg breaking his silence about their massive data breach. Millions of users had their information improperly obtained by a data firm linked to President Trump's campaign to try to sway the election. What Zuckerberg now says that Facebook is doing to safeguard your privacy and future elections, and whether he will volunteer to testify to Congress. So while Congress is considering regulating social media giants like Facebook, the House is poised to vote on a $1.3 trillion spending deal today. You'll hear the word, the omnibus bill. We'll tell you what's in it and what isn't in the 2,232-page spending package that you can almost guarantee almost none of your lawmakers will have read in its entirety. But the big question is, can they avoid another shutdown tomorrow night? We'll see.
While President Trump's legal team weighs an interview with the special counsel, CNN is learning about four topics Robert Mueller wants to ask the president about. And it comes as President Trump defends his congratulatory call to Vladimir Putin while slamming his predecessors. We are also learning new details about the Austin serial bomber, police finding a 25-minute video confession on his cell phone. We'll tell you if officials at this point are any closer to determining his motive. And also, if the threat of more bombs is over. A lot to cover this morning. We begin with CNN's Lori Siegel, who is live in San Francisco with her exclusive interview with Mark Zuckerberg. Lori, good morning.
Morning. Well, I think for a while we're all wondering, where is Mark Zuckerberg? The question's been answered. I came out to Menlo Park to his office to talk to him, to talk about what's been a rough year and also an incredibly rough couple days for the company. And you know what, you guys, he sat down with me and he started out saying what I think a lot of people wanted him to say, which was, I'm sorry. Take a listen. I want to start with just a basic question, Mark. What happened? What went wrong?
So this was a major breach of trust, and I'm really sorry that this happened. You know, we have a basic responsibility to protect people's data. And if we can't do that, then we don't deserve to have the opportunity to serve people. So our responsibility now is to make sure that this doesn't happen again.
Facebook has asked us to share our data, to share our lives on this platform, and has wanted us to be transparent. And people don't feel like they've received that same amount of transparency. They're wondering what's happening to their data. Can they trust Facebook?
Yeah, so one of the most important things that I think we need to do here is make sure that we tell everyone whose data was affected by one of these rogue apps, right? And we're going to do that. We're going to build a tool where anyone can go and see if their data was a part of this.
But, so the 50 million people that were impacted, they will be able to tell if they were impacted by this.
We're going to be even conservative on that. So, you know, we may not have all of the data in our system today. So anyone whose data might have been affected by this, we're going to make sure that we tell. And going forward, when we identify apps that are similarly doing sketchy things, we're going to make sure that we tell people then too, right? And that's definitely something that, you know, looking back on this, you know, I regret that we didn't do it at the time. And I think we got that wrong, and we're committed to getting that right going forward.
Like, I want to ask about that, because when this came to light, you guys knew this a long time ago, that this data was out there. Why didn't you tell users? Don't you think users have the right to know that their data is being used for different purposes?
So, yes. And let me tell you what actions we took. So in 2015, some journalists from The Guardian told us that they had seen or had some evidence that data that this app developer, Alexander Kogan, who built this personality quiz app and a bunch of people used it and shared data with it, had sold that data to Cambridge Analytica and a few other firms. And when we heard that, and that's against the policies, right? I mean, you can't share data in a way that people don't know or don't consent to. We immediately banned Kogan's app. And further, we made it so that Kogan and Cambridge Analytica and the other folks with whom we shared the data, we asked for a formal certification that they had none of the data from anyone in the Facebook community, that they deleted it if they had it, and that they weren't using it. And they all provided that certification. So as far as we understood around the time of that episode, There was no data out there.
So why didn't Facebook follow up? You know, you say you certified it. I think, why wasn't there more of a follow-up? Why wasn't there an audit then? Why does it take a big media report to get that proactive approach?
Well, I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm used to when people legally certify that they're going to do something, that they do it. But I think that this was clearly a mistake in retrospect.
Was it putting too much trust in developers?
I think it did. And that's why, you know, we need to make sure that we don't make that mistake ever again.
Knowing what you know now, do you believe Facebook impacted the results of the 2016 election?
Oh, that is hard. You know, I think that it's really hard for me to have a full assessment of that. You know, it's the reality is, well, there were so many different forces at play. Right, the organic posting that people did, the get out the vote campaigns that we ran, the pages that both candidates ran, the advertising that they did, I'm sure that all of that activity had some impact. It's hard for me to assess how much that stacked up compared to all of the campaign events and advertising that was done off of Facebook and all of the other efforts. And I think it's also hard to fully assess the impact of that organic activity, which we're actually quite proud of, right?
But also the bad actors
and the bad stuff. That's,
you know,
what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So I think it is. It's hard to fully assess. If you told me in 2004, when I was getting started with Facebook, that a big part of my responsibility today would be to help protect the integrity of elections against interference by other governments, you know, I wouldn't have really believed that was going to be something that I would have to work on 14 years later.
I'm going to challenge
you. But we're here now.
I'm going to challenge you.
And we're going to make sure that we do a good job at it.
Have you done a good enough job yet?
Well, I think we will see. But, you know, I think what's clear is that in 2016, we were not as on top of a number of issues as we should have, whether it was Russian interference or fake news. But what we have seen since then is, you know, a number of months later, there was a major French election. And there we deployed some AI tools that did a much better job of identifying Russian bots.
I can hear the commitment, but since I got you here, do you think that bad actors are using Facebook at this moment to meddle with the U.S. midterm elections?
I'm sure someone's trying, right? And I'm sure that there's, V2 of version 2 of whatever the Russian effort was in 2016. I'm sure they're working on that, and there are going to be some new tactics that we need to make sure that we observe and get in front of.
Do you know speaking of getting in front of them, do you know what they are? Do you have any idea?
I mean, yes, and I think we have some sense of the different things that we need to get in front of.
You hear him talking quite a bit about this. You know, Facebook right now is under a tremendous amount of pressure financially, also legally, with lawmakers all around the world, you know, asking Mark Zuckerberg to show up, asking him to testify. I actually asked him about this. I said, there are calls for you to testify. Will you show up? Listen to what he said.
The short answer is I'm happy to if it's the right thing to do. You know, Facebook testifies in Congress regularly on a number of topics, some high profile and some not. So what we try to do is send the person at Facebook who will have the most knowledge about what Congress is trying to learn. So if that's me, then I am happy to go.
You know, I followed up and said, I think people want it to be you. You are the brand name of Facebook. You, Mark Zuckerberg is Facebook. Facebook is Mark Zuckerberg. And I think that's why so many people wanted to hear from him during this moment of crisis. You know, oftentimes when there's a moment of crisis at tech companies in the tech world, maybe it's not the CEO that always comes forward. Maybe, but the difference here is that Mark Zuckerberg, Sheryl Sandberg, these are brand names. And this platform that impacts 2 billion people is so incredibly personal to us. And we've seen so much happen in the last year that I think people really want those leaders to step up, show up, and give us a little transparency, guys.
Yeah, I mean, I would flip the reality there and say, you point me an example when you had a major corporation like Facebook where it was called to the carpet and you didn't see the face and the head of the organization there. I think you're going to have a very short list. All right, Lori, stay with us. Let's also bring in CNN political analyst David Gregory. Okay, so this is an unusual position for the Zuck, and he is clearly uncomfortable with it. Took a lot of time for him to come forward. His answers leave a lot to be desired. What is his political future in terms of facing some kind of congressional testimony, in your opinion, David?
I think you're going to see him in Washington, and he's going to have to face down these committees. I mean, it's frankly laughable that, you know, whoever is knows most about, you know, these issues is one who testifies. Sorry, he's accountable. It's Mark Zuckerberg. He's going to be dragged before Capitol Hill. And you know what? These tech companies generally don't like this level of accountability or scrutiny. They've enjoyed a much cozier relationship with the government when they felt that they were kindred spirits with more progressives who were in government, and now they're seeing that things have changed, that those same progressives are going to crack down on them, especially in the way that the site has been compromised, and that this open platform that can bring people together all over the world can also be corrupted. So there's questions of regulation that they face, that they will bridle against. And there's the fundamental question of what is Facebook? And what is it going to be in the future? Is it a journalistic organization? Does it have a responsibility to monitor content, to fact-check content? All of these are very difficult questions. I don't know the answer, but they've got to face down this reality and understand that they have to face questions. You know, not to boil this down to just a PR response, but it is telling of the culture of companies like Facebook that they took so long to respond. You know, that it took them so long to formulate a response to a huge story like this. They have been behind. The fact that they have been there, that data has been breached, privacy has been breached, and they're responsible for it.
And what's fascinating to that point, David, and Lori, I'll throw this one to you, is this is not the first time that Facebook has had an issue, and certainly not recently. So to your point, David, of the lacking PR response, the fact that this story broke last Friday, and now he didn't sit down with you, Lori, until last night. The statement they put out prior to your interview was lacking in many ways and criticized almost as quickly as it came out for what it was lacking. What is going on in terms of management, Lori, when we look at not only the response, but the lack of action?
You know, it's really interesting. Before we actually sat down, I was hearing from folks at the company. There was really some frustration with high-level executives saying Mark needs to be out in front of this. There was this idea that he's not getting his hands dirty enough, that he's almost in his own filter bubble. He has his own comms people. He's being protected in his own way, and it's more people looking out for Mark and not the company. So I think, you know, that we kind of reached a boiling point. He had to talk, but I think anyone in crisis management, PR would say it's better to get out in front of these early. And I think it's not just this specific situation. It's looking at the last year. I think users are fed up. I think people are looking at Facebook and they're wondering what they're looking at. Are they being manipulated by ads? Who's advertising towards them? And I'll tell you, from knowing a lot of folks behind the scenes, they're working on some incredibly important issues that impact all of us, that don't have easy answers. One person said, you know, we're not allowed to talk about this because it's not black and white. When we crack down on fake news, then we toy the line with censorship in some ways.
Right.
These are gray area topics that we need to be able to talk about, and they're not sound bites. But I'll also say, on my end, I'll say, but they're also not blog posts, and they're also not quick Facebook lives. They need to be a public discussion. And there's a feeling behind the scenes in Facebook with senior executives, you know, that these need to be put out there a little bit more, even though they're challenging topics. This is a challenging time, and what's happened to
right.
Facebook with its reach is incredibly challenging.
Right, but look, let's be honest. These platforms are in the business of having big numbers, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to now start cultivating and curating those numbers, getting rid of fake accounts, getting rid of different types of deceptions, they're worried about their numbers. This is a numbers business. But they've been free from regulation. David, the big point is, will that change? This isn't just about Facebook. They're the biggest. We're working on a documentary right now about online dating. I have a guy who has spent years trying to get Facebook with some other people to take down fake profiles of his face. He's in the military, and people love to steal the identities of military people and pose as them online for different types of scams. He's got a 50-50 success rate with these social media platforms, years of dedicated effort. What does that tell you? They act out of consequence, not out of conscience. They could do a lot better. They haven't because regulators aren't on their ass, right? Let's be honest.
Yeah.
That's the difference between this industry. Do you think that changes?
Well, I think it's going to change. And let's remember during the debate over government efforts to secure metadata and other electronic surveillance in the fight against terrorism, how a lot of these tech companies were at the forefront of saying that this was government overreach and it was so inappropriate. Well, that was a convenient dodge for what they do in terms of gathering up all of our private information to not only boost their numbers, but to sell to advertisers, which is why, you know, you can be on a website and, you know, there the shoes,
you
bought last week are advertising.
Right. David Gregory and I are talking about the latest soft sandal for men in the summer season. And next thing you know, there are all these ads from Coach and all these other places. That's not a coincidence.
Right, exactly. But the point is, so I think there's a lot more regulation on that. And again, this question of how you control information when in a free marketplace of information it can be compromised. That's a serious issue as we see in our elections.
They cultivate information when it works for them. Will they control information when it helps everybody else? That is the big question. Lori Siegel, thank you so much for this information at such a critical time. It was great to hear from him, especially after all this time. Thank you, Lori. David, as always.
Thanks.
CNN has learned special counsel Robert Mueller is eager to question President Trump about four main topics. This, of course, as the president is defending his congratulatory call to Vladimir Putin and slamming his predecessor. CNN's Abby Phillip is live this morning at the White House with more. Abby, good morning.
Well, good morning, Erica. President Trump is growing increasingly frustrated that despite what his aides have told him, the Mueller investigation appears to be nowhere near an end. And while these details of a potential sit-down between President Trump and investigators are still being worked out, we are learning a little bit more about what Mueller might want to ask him about. As the president's lawyers prepare for a potential sit-down between Mr. Trump and special counsel Robert Mueller's investigators, CNN learning that the special counsel's team has shared four main topics they want to discuss, including the circumstances surrounding the Trump Tower meeting between Donald Trump Jr. and several Russians in June 2016, and what role the president played in crafting the misleading initial statement aboard Air Force One that suggested the meeting was about Russian adoptions.
The president weighed in as any father would based on the limited information that he had.
It later surfaced that Don Jr. took the meeting because he was promised dirt on Hillary Clinton. A source tells CNN the bulk of Mueller's interview will focus on the firing of National Security Advisor Michael Flynn and the firing of FBI Director James Comey.
And in fact, when I decided to just do it, I said to myself, I said, you know, this Russia thing with Trump and Russia is a made-up story.
Based on these topics, a source says the president's legal team has written dozens of potential questions Mueller's team could ask. This, as the Washington Post reports, that President Trump surprised his senior advisors when on Tuesday he suggested meeting with Russian President Vladimir Putin.
We had a very good call, and I suspect that we'll probably be meeting in the not-too-distant future.
According to the Post, officials say there are no plans for Trump and Putin to even be in the same country until November. President Trump is already preparing for a potential summit in May with North Korean dictator Kim Jong-un. President Trump defending his phone call with Putin to congratulate him on his re-election, attacking his predecessors, and insisting that getting along with Russia is a good thing amid criticism from his own party.
I wouldn't have a conversation with a criminal.
A source tells CNN the president was furious after it leaked that his briefing materials included a warning that read, in capital letters, do not congratulate. Some Republicans on the Hill echoing that frustration.
Whoever did that ought to be fired immediately, and I think they ought to be prosecuted.
Well, turning to tariffs today, the president is going to be announcing some new trade tariffs on China, this time targeting $50 billion in goods coming into the U.S. from China. Meanwhile, that country has threatened to retaliate against the United States, Chris.
All right, Ab, thank you very much. Now that we know what Robert Mueller wants to ask the president about, what does that tell us about where the investigation is heading and whether or not the president will cooperate? Let's dig deeper next. All right, so if you're like me and Erica and probably, you know, most of you out there, it's early, 6:20, kids are starting to get up, get ready for school, there'll be some spats. People will say, well, you know what he said to me?
Yeah.
And you know what I'm going to do to him? And you're going to say, whoa, whoa. Hey, we don't talk like
it's
that
early.
To each other. You know, that's not the way you talk. Even if he did say something you don't like. That, before you go dishing out that advice, listen to what the president of the United States just tweeted this morning. Crazy Joe Biden, of course, referring to our former vice president, is trying to act like a tough guy. Actually, he is weak, both mentally and physically. And yet, he threatens me for the second time with physical assault. He doesn't know me, but he would go down fast and hard, crying all the way. Don't threaten people, Joe. That's the level of discourse that we have going on in the country right now, and we should all be telling our kids it ain't acceptable, okay? So let's get back to news and away from Crazy Joe and all the crazy, period. CNN has learned that there are four main topics that special counsel Bob Mueller's investigators wants to talk to the president about if they ever interview him, okay? This is what sources tell CNN they are. The circumstances surrounding Don Jr.'s June meeting in 2016 with Russians in Trump Tower. The president's role in crafting the resulting statement about that meeting on Air Force One. And the firings of FBI Director Jim Comey and National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. Let's get into this with David Gregory and CNN Politics reporter and editor-at-large Chris Cillizza. And the reason I'm not going to give the tweet anymore, it should come out. It's embarrassing. He should be embarrassed. But he isn't. And we know the state of play politically. So let's move on. David, of these four questions, the big question is, will they encourage involvement by the executive, namely the president, or do you think this chills the chances that we see any type of formal confrontation?
Well, I think the president is still at some level itching to have a one-on-one with Mueller and his team because he's so confident that there's nothing that he has to hide and that he's done nothing wrong and that he's probably the best witness on his behalf. Now, his lawyers probably feel differently because of the legal jeopardy that he could be in. I think what's clear from these topic areas, of course, as we've been suggesting all along, that obstruction of justice by the president himself is something that they are looking at once the investigation was underway. And I felt for the longest time that the president has done so much to bring these difficulties on himself because he doesn't like the fact that the investigation was accelerating and where the investigation started. But as you've pointed out many times, you know, the idea that this is heading toward a potential indictment of the president is off base. This could certainly be fodder for information in a report that's passed on to Congress for an impeachment proceeding if it ever gets to that. So it could become fodder for a political process rather than a legal process. But it's obviously interesting, and it focuses on, in this area, what the president either knew about directly or did himself with the investigation.
And to David's point of the president sort of itching and wanting to sit down, because we do know he wants this to move forward. He wants it wrapped up, obviously. He wanted it wrapped up months ago. It's also fascinating, as we've seen him this week, try to really take more of the reins in terms of his legal team. Yeah. Not only in swapping out, right, and bringing people in, including just DeGenova, but also DeGenova, but also even these, we're learning these overtures that were made to Ted Olson,
yeah,
reportedly, where he is not joining. But as we watch him try to take more control, it'll be interesting to see whether that actually pushes anything up in terms of getting him in front of Robert Mueller.
So I think, Erica, what you've seen with the legal team, what you've seen with Donald Trump's approach, such as it is in the last 5-6 days, is a move toward trying to win the post-Mueller investigation probe release, which is that Donald Trump was under the false impression for a long time, well, we'll just, this is all going to be over soon. His lawyers had told him that. I think he now realizes it's probably not going to be over soon. It's probably not going to be good. Now, that doesn't mean it's bad for him personally, but it's not going to be a good day of headlines, and that he is working now. Joe DeGenova is a perfect example of someone who's really, yes, a lawyer, but more of a talking head to go out there and frame, mm-hmm, interesting word choice by me, but go out there and frame what this is. And Joe DeGenova is on the record saying, oh, this is a frame-up job, right? Donald Trump is being framed by the CIA and FBI. So I think he's preparing for the post-Mueller report to win the PR battle. Can I make one point about the tweet, Chris? I know you don't like
it,
but I do. I do think it is important that amid three civil lawsuits related to groping, alleged sexual assault, amid the ongoing Mueller investigation, amid the leaked phone call that I think speaks to the dysfunction in the White House and the lack of respect, the lack of trust that some people work for him have, that this, which is a comment made by Joe Biden to the Miami University College Democrats, which is essentially like, we used to take bullies behind the school and punch them in the nose.
It's not the first time you said it.
He was referencing, too, for people who aren't familiar with it, he was referencing what he perceives as the way Donald Trump treats women, and
correct,
that's why he was saying yes.
That Donald Trump, out of all of those things that have happened, that this is the thing that he chooses to focus on, I think is telling. It's not new. We know this is his personality, but I think it is telling in that it speaks to what he is focused on and what he cares about, which out of all the things I just listed, Joe Biden saying something about Donald Trump shouldn't even be on that list. And yet that's where his mind is. And that, I think, should worry you if you're a Republican.
Well, here's the thing, David. Donald Trump looks at his public life, fair to say, as a street fight. Every day is a street fight. And that goes back to well before he thought of getting into politics, although he considered politics a street fight back in the 80s when he's railing against Ronald Reagan. So, you know, he sees that as a street fight against Mueller, against people who are suing him for sexual misconduct. And by the way, if you're Trump and you're looking at all of this, you know, the fact that you could have a special counsel who's just out there investigating, and then you have to get deposed in these lawsuits. We've seen this movie before, right? It was the Clinton impeachment story. He could get dragged into that. So there's no question as to why I think he feels and why he's kind of flailing around so angry about the fact that this is moving forward and that other things could be drawn into this. And, you know, the piece about what's happening internally at the White House, I think, is really interesting. You know, we can't behave like these things have never happened before. There's all kinds of leaks that come. And by the way, this leak about the Russia phone call could have come from the NSC staff. It could have come from the Hill, who were briefed on how this call was supposed to go. It could have come from the State Department. It could have even come from DOD. The government does this, you know, where there's people who have different points of view who will leak information. But even during the Bush White House, during the, you know, the Iraq War and some real disagreements about that, you saw leaks, but you didn't see being undermined by staff in this way. But that speaks to the kind of White House that that this president is running.
Very quickly, pressure cooker. Donald Trump under increasing pressure, increasingly isolated. Twitter is his pressure release valve. I think you'll see even more unpresidential behavior on Twitter. But I think this is sort of the last 5 or 6 days, it's indicative of what we're going to continue to see.
All right, thank you both. Police say they have a video confession from the Austin serial bomber. So does it shed any clues as to why he carried out this deadly series of attacks? We have those new details for you coming up next.
All right, so Austin police revealed that the serial bomber did leave behind a 25-minute video that they're calling a confession on his phone because it describes each of the bombs that he says he built. Now, the big question will be, does it reveal anything about why he built these bombs and tried to hurt people? CNN's Nick Valencia live in Austin with more. What do we know, Nick?
Good morning, Chris. We're here in Pflugerville, Texas, just a few feet away from the bomber's home. It's where police say he made those explosives that he used to terrorize his community over the course of the last 3 weeks. You can see behind me that they are still treating this very much so as an active crime scene, trying to glean any information they can about the 23-year-old. But what they have found over the course of the last 24 hours is a 25-minute phone video recording. They're calling it a confession. And the police chief was quick to mention that there was no mention of terrorism, no mention of hate, but he did talk specifically about the six explosives that he used over the course of the last 3 weeks, as well as a seventh, they believe, the one that he used to detonate, killing himself as he was cornered by police. Now, we are starting to learn a little bit more about this 23-year-old. We know that he was homeschooled in this area, eventually going on to Austin Community College for 2 years before he dropped out. His family is also speaking out, saying that they're saddened by the crimes that he committed over the course of the last 3 weeks. We should mention that these attacks, they left two people dead and several others severely injured, including a 75-year-old woman that's still in the hospital recovering from her injuries. Erica?
Nick, thank you. As we have been following that closely out of Austin, we also want to catch up about what's happening along the East Coast. Millions of folks digging out this morning after that fourth nor'easter to hit the region this month. The powerful winter storm dumping heavy snow, forcing thousands of flights to be canceled. CNN meteorologist Chad Myers joining us now with the forecast. Chad, good morning.
Good morning, Erica. I tell you what, it was a rough night for a lot of folks. Ice slip, though, you'll be digging out for 14 inches. There are other spots on Long Island with higher numbers, also Connecticut as well. LaGuardia about 8 inches, Central Park about the same, and then Philadelphia down to Dulles a little bit less. This weather is brought to you by Green Mountain Coffee Roasters, packed with goodness, and you may need an extra cup today. It is still snowing in some places, but the snow is going to taper off today. By noon, it's just about done. Even for New York City, it's done now. But for Boston, it finally ends around 4 o'clock today. Still putting down 1 or 2 more inches, but that's it. The good news is that we get to 40 46 in New York City today, so that will melt some of the snow. The problem is, tonight we get down to 32 in the suburbs, significantly down to about 28, which means more freezing of that melted snow. So more ice tomorrow morning as you drive to work tomorrow morning, anywhere from D.C. all the way up into Boston. The story for tomorrow, Chris, is that there's a major flood event going on in Southern California today. We'll have that for you tomorrow. I have one other word for you, and that's fake spring. Tired of it.
Two words, but I accept it. And
put them together with a hashtag.
You have warned people before, and I will repeat it for their benefit now. This is when people get hurt. When you see the thaw and then it freezes, you want to make time to work tomorrow morning because you're going to have some delays because of the snow. The ice can be a killer. Be safe. Chad Myers taught me that. He was right. Chad, thank you very much. Congressional leaders agree on a $1 trillion spending bill. It's actually more than that, but the numbers are so big that a few hundred billion, we'll just leave it to the side.
Once you hit a trillion, I mean.
Is there enough support to get it passed to avoid a government shutdown? And what compromises have been made in order to get past that deadline? The details, next.
Are you working out now?
Oh, no. Just some light reading I have here. This is the proposed omnibus bill, 2,232 pages. The average man couldn't lift it, but I'll put it right here. We actually only printed out the first page. All the rest of this is paper that was recycled and will be used in our printer.
Yes, I'm glad to hear that. You know, I actually went for the version on CNN.com that tells you what's in it. It's only two pages when you print it out.
Oh, well.
Just for the future.
You could have done that also, sure, but then you couldn't have lifted up this massive thing.
I probably couldn't have lifted anyway, to your point.
All right, so why are we showing you this? Because this is how big the damn thing is, and many of the lawmakers are not going to have a chance and will be kind and say, I'm sure they would if they had the chance to read all of it. But they won't be able to, all right? So this is going to be about what the leadership tells them is in here and why they need to vote for it. And that just shows you a little bit of the dysfunction of the process. Let's discuss what's in this bad boy and what it means for you. We have CNN political analyst David Gregory and associate editor for Real Clear Politics, A.B. Stoddard, who could lift this with three fingers. All right, so David Gregory, let's talk about main compromises we have in here. One of the loudest voices coming out right now is Susan Collins from Maine, Republican. She had been trying very hard across the aisle to get in a provision to get the cost-sharing payments back from the federal government, in essence, to lower people's insurance premiums. She wasn't able to get it in this bill. Why, and what does it mean going forward?
Well, look, there was a lot of trade-offs in this bill that that everybody had to accept. Even the president was tweeting about the fact that he got some money for border security and for paying for the wall, although it was discussed differently about using existing technology to pay for more border reinforcements in some wall, but not a concrete wall, in exchange for more domestic payments, more funding for domestic programs that Democrats wanted, so that there's something for both sides, which is how these kind of bigger agreements come out, where both sides have to say, yeah, it's not perfect. But we were able to get enough priorities to keep moving.
And that is part of what we heard, because we are seeing from both sides, well, there are obviously parties that are not happy with the way this turned out. You are seeing some positive spin from both sides this time around. Chuck Schumer even saying, hey, you know what, we made some compromise, but there's a lot in here that really is good for middle-class families, for children. AB, is that the way it's actually going to play out?
Well, I mean, first of all, remember, people would need to understand that this 2,232 pages is for 6 months. We don't know exactly how, you know, everything is going to play out in terms of the promises making a big difference. But certainly there's bipartisan praise about the fact that there is $3 billion more for National Institutes of Health, that there is $21 billion in infrastructure, that there is $4.6 billion. For opioid treatment, and it really is, you know, those are bipartisan issues. Mm-hmm. So there is a lot for everyone. What's interesting, though, is that they did not tackle either the Dreamer issue or the healthcare stabilization. And what Chris raised is really an interesting thing for Republicans going into this election. This is the last, this bill is the last train leaving the station. They won't be doing anything else this year, and they admit that. The fact that they refused after 6 months to deal with this Obamacare stabilization issue. When Senator Lamar Alexander, Republican, has been begging the president, thought he had his word about this over the weekend to include this, so did Senator Collins, is really, in the end, a political problem for Republicans. They're not watching the polls where health care is the number one issue, not sanctuary cities, not a wall, not ISIS, not anything. It's health care. And those prices are going to skyrocket. And so that is a big political risk for them leaving this out of the
It's bill. Interesting you say that, AB. Just as word as this came out, but what wasn't it and what wasn't, you started to see propagandists put out there for Republican voters, immigration is the top voting issue. It's going to be what hits their pocketbook. Now, one of the reasons we're playing with this, right, is that this is all about goodies, okay? That's what's in this. This is all so that lawmakers can go back to their districts before the midterms and say, look what I got you down there, all right? So, David, I think we need one more beat on what Collins was trying to get done. When they got rid of the individual mandate, it was a great headline for President Trump because it became symbolic of the hostility toward the ACA. But it also created a huge divot in the funding mechanism and what would balance payments for the providers, okay? So now you have a shortfall. They're seeing more risk. There are less people in the pool. So they're going to start raising their rates, and we're seeing that happen. This was a way to get away from it. Collins says, I couldn't get it done because of the Democrats, all right? Now, what was it that the Democrats wanted that made them not go along with Collins' ask on this?
Well, you'll have to ask AB. I don't know the particulars about what the Democrats wanted, but I think what's important about this is the structure of how the ACA works and the fact that what people are going to feel, to your point about people going to the polls, is premiums rise because in the end, as we've always talked about with health care, the insurance companies have to be taken care of if they're not going to pass on the raise in rates to consumers. So you can't partially dismantle the architecture of Obamacare and think that it's going to be shored up. It's got to be shored up somehow to avoid it really impacting consumers.
So AB, what's the short, what is that other piece? David gives us the right analysis of it. What was the pushback from Democrats?
There's pushback. It usually comes down to abortion and Planned Parenthood funding and how that works in the insurance mechanism. And that's why you see Mark Meadows, head of the Freedom Caucus, saying that this bill funds Obamacare, funds Planned Parenthood, funds sanctuary cities, is too expensive, doesn't fund a wall, and it is not what the forgotten men and women voted for. So he's been telling Trump all week not to support this. But that's usually what happens is that when it
so
came
who was
down.
Right? So the Democrats said these
payments... No. Republicans also did not want to shore up Obamacare. That is a huge political hot button for them. They don't want to be seen with their base after a promise of 7 years to repeal and replace looking like they're shoring up Obamacare.
And let me just say there's a bigger point here, too, about some of the things that are not addressed, whether it's, gun legislation, whether it's the Dreamers, whether it's health care. Again, the president promised and is going to have to write and going to have to go to voters and say, look, I can get deals. I can get things done in a way that nobody else could. And yet he's had to avoid even areas where I think he could have had these deals, the most difficult things because he can't get agreement. He can't force the agreement, which looks a lot like his predecessors.
Still a lot to hash out there, and interesting to you bring up what voters care about, and we know from polling they actually care about Dreamers as well too, and they want that addressed, and nothing has happened with
and
that
buried in these pages is the story of what's getting done and what's not getting done. Who's going to read it? We'll see.
I'll tell you one thing that is getting done. Little March Madness resumes tonight.
This is CNN breaking news.
This is CNN Tonight. I'm Don Lemon. Thank you so much for joining us. And we have breaking news on the Russia investigation to tell you about. We're learning more tonight about what Robert Mueller's team is focusing on. Here's what sources are telling CNN. Now, the special counsel wants to question President Trump about four main topics so far. Anyway, four main topics. The source also says the president's legal team is creating a list of dozens of potential questions Mueller's team could ask. And with Trump already angry about the Mueller investigation and blasting it as a witch hunt, CNN has learned the president was fuming last night when news leaked that his national security advisors had warned him, in all caps, not to congratulate Vladimir Putin on his reelection. The president reportedly quizzed his allies and outside advisors, asking them to tell him who they thought was the leaker. One source says the latest leak contributes to an atmosphere of paranoia in the West Wing. But this is a president who doesn't hesitate to throw his own people right under the bus. Just ask Jeff Sessions, He doesn't hesitate to fire them as long as he doesn't have to do it face to face. Just ask Rex Tillerson, not to mention James Comey or Michael Flynn and a host of other people. So what's behind all these leaks? Is it about fighting back, or is it for the good of the country? Then there's this. This is from the former director of the CIA, John Brennan, telling MSNBC he thinks President Trump is afraid of Vladimir Putin, and going on to say, quote, the Russians could have something on him personally that they could always roll out and make his life more difficult. There's no public evidence of that, but it's a pretty stunning statement by an intelligence professional, right? I'm going to ask another former CIA director, Michael Hayden, about that. Plus, we have new developments in the lawsuit filed by a former apprentice contestant against the president. Trump's attorney plans to appeal a judge's decision to allow the defamation lawsuit to go forward. Her name is Summer Zervos. She says Trump groped her in 2006, and she says he defamed her by calling her a liar. More on that later on in the show. A lot to get to, but I want to bring in CNN senior White House correspondent Pamela Brown. Pamela, good evening to you. You can see Pamela's live at the White House this evening. I hope you're warm out there in the middle of this snowstorm we're having here on the East Coast. You know, you're getting new details about what Mueller's team has discussed with the president's attorneys. What are you learning?
That's right. Don, the special counsel investigators have indicated four main areas that they would like to discuss with the president during a potential sit-down interview. They include the president's role in crafting that statement aboard Air Force One to miscast the meeting that his son had at Trump Tower with Russians in June of 2016. They also want to know more about that meeting at Trump Tower that Don Jr. had with the Russians and what the president knew about it. As you know, the president has said he didn't know anything until much later. But clearly, Robert Mueller's team is interested in that, according to sources. They also want to learn more about the circumstances surrounding the firings of former FBI Director James Comey and former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn and the president's actions there. Now, a source familiar, Don, says a bulk of what Robert Mueller's team is looking to speak with the president about has to do with those firings. And from all of this information, the president's legal team has basically put together a memo of dozens of potential questions that the president could be asked. Now, whether there will be an interview, it remains to be seen, Don. In fact, I'm told by a source that the president's legal team is looking to add to its ranks more lawyers as it enters this next phase to decide what will happen. One thing is for sure, though, Don, the president is growing increasingly agitated. As we see here, Robert Mueller wants to talk to him about his own behavior. This is about the president himself. That is something that has been frustrating to him. Sarah Sanders at the podium yesterday, I was asking her about Robert Mueller, the Russia probe. It was clear she's frustrated, saying that the president has been mercilessly attacked. So we'll have to wait and see how this plays out from here, Don.
So given that, any sense of a timeline on how soon could the president potentially sit down with Mueller's team, Pamela?
Well, I'm told, Don, that there could be a decision made just within the next couple of weeks. So that is why one source said we're entering a new phase here. We need more people, more lawyers to try to sort of make this decision to decide how to handle this from here. The president himself has vacillated. I'm told that he initially wanted to come out and sit down with Robert Mueller. He said it on the record in January that he would love to do it under oath. But now, as it's becoming increasingly clear what Robert Mueller wants to focus on, the fact that this probe is not slowing down, the president sort of is getting different advice from lawyers. So we will have to wait and see. But a decision on whether or not it will happen, whether his lawyers will allow it to happen, is expected to be made within the next couple of weeks, Don.
Pamela Brown, much appreciated. Thank you so much. I want to bring in now CNN Politics Editor-at-Large Chris Saliza, CNN Political Analyst Ryan Lizza, CNN Contributor John Dean, the former Nixon White House counsel. I got to get my Salizas and Lizzas right this evening.
Well,
it can be confusing sometimes. So that said, I'm going to start with John. Good evening to all of you, by the way. John, so CNN is learning about these four main focuses, the focus area that Mueller is interested in talking to the president about, with particular interest in the president's actions related to Comey and the Flynn firings. What type of case does this sound like to you? Is it an obstruction of justice case, given what you know?
Well, there certainly are some questions there that would directly relate to a obstruction case. But Don, I don't think we really know what he's going to ask, and he's not going to be bound by any agreement as to what he'll ask. He's going to go where he thinks he needs to go. He's going to go within the four corners of the general charge he's got from the Deputy Attorney General as to what he's to investigate. and he's not going to be restrained. So I don't think we can really figure out what's going to happen in that session.
Mm-hmm. And the backdrop of the new details we're learning about today is the president's Twitter tirade against Mueller and the investigation. That's the backdrop here.
Yeah, and I think it's important to remember, Don, this is a pressure cooker. Last night we were talking about Summer Zervos, Karen McDougal, and Stormy Daniels. Now this, the Putin phone call. Donald Trump says he likes to operate in chaos. He believes that that's the way in which he works best. He thinks it best ideas come out of that. But I think what you see is Twitter has always been his pressure release valve. It's the thing that no one can ever take from him, despite people trying to many times over. And I think you'll see that increasingly. We saw some of it this afternoon. We've seen some of it over the last few days. I think you'll continue to see that because I think he's getting increasingly frustrated, pressure on, less staff he can rely on. Remember, Hope Hicks on her way out, less people he trusts around him who don't have other conflicts they need to deal with that their minds are focused on. So I think you're going to see him turn even more to Twitter to express himself, which probably is against the advice of his lawyers, but... Yeah. When's he listened to them?
Well, you mentioned Stormy Daniels. He's not turning Twitter for that.
That's a whole other panel.
And that's later on in this show. So let's stick with Russia now and Mueller. And I'm going to ask you about the four areas. But let me just read them quickly before I ask you, Ryan. I almost called you Chris Ryan. The president's role in crafting the statement aboard Air Force One, right, that miscast Donald Trump Jr.'s campaign at the 2016 meeting. The circumstances surrounding the Trump Tower meeting, as well as that, the firing of the FBI Director James Comey, and the firing of National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. So those are the ones that, what they're talking about now. So his interests go beyond those four topics, though. Don't you think it goes beyond that? It goes beyond just simple collusion, I would think, that it points to. And that's why I asked John about, is this an obstruction case? So this is not ending anytime soon.
It's sprawling. Just think of all the buckets here. Number one, it gets to the basic issue of collusion. Two and three on your list get to more of the obstruction of justice. Four, I think, is one that's gotten a little bit forgotten in the recent months of a lot of news, is this Flynn case and whether Mueller is looking into a Logan Act violation. Remember the Logan Act?
We were talking about that.
And you go back and you read the filings in the Flynn case. And remember, he admitted to lying to the FBI. There's some interesting clues in there. He talks about a very senior official in the transition who knew about the conversations he was having with the Russian ambassador. Mueller has been focused on those conversations, and he wants to know who told Flynn to say what to the Russian ambassador. We don't know who that very senior official is. Is it Jared Kushner? Is it Pence? Is it Trump? So I think that's something that we haven't talked about in a long time is, and remember this Logan Act that's been on the books for centuries, but has not actually been enforced much, but it's basically, are you conducting a foreign policy independently that tries to thwart the current American government's foreign policy? That's what Flynn was on his way to being charged with when he admitted to the lie. Anyway, so that's one bucket. And then the stuff outside of that list, we have this recent issue of the subpoena to the Trump Organization. So, right, is Mueller now looking at something that the Trump Organization did completely outside of Russia or, you know, related to Russia? And so that's a lot of issues. And then we still don't have any indictments. I think the most obvious indictment from what we know publicly is going to be something related to Russians who were involved with the hacking and dumping campaign of the DNC and Podesta emails. Yeah. So this investigation is going on for a long time.
Can I just highlight one thing? Because I think, Ryan, we lose sight because so much happens, right? Yeah. We talk about this all the time. So much happens every day. You lose sight of it. But the Flynn plea deal and cooperation, I think, is of huge import. You know, it's not the most recent thing that happened.
What was one of
that's a major
one of the first things I reported. I reported the Flynn. I mean, Flynn was fired or let go.
That's a huge deal because of all of them, whatever you think of George Papadopoulos, whatever you think of Rick Gates, there is no question that Michael Flynn was there at the beginning, roughly. Yeah. He was there in the central part of the campaign. He was in the leadership team. And then he was the national security advisor in the White House. So that plea deal and cooperation pledge, the belief by Mueller that Flynn knows enough that a plea deal is worthwhile, and then Flynn's cooperation. Do not underestimate that. I think that may be a key.
Well, let's bring in the man who would know about that.
Yeah, come on, John.
He's sitting
Neither
right here.
Neither of us ever handled that.
I know. So,
like
John,
seen in the Woody Allen movie. We've actually got the person.
And if you agree with that, John, that's a lot of legal landmines for the president. No wonder the president's like, oh my gosh, can't this just be over with?
For sure. One thing also, if you take all this, put it together, what you're really looking at is a grand conspiracy. And those are the counts that he's raising, for example, in the 13 Russians he charged with conspiracy, with the Manafort case and the Gates case. Those were conspiracy cases. So he's actually building a defraud the United States case that could be both domestic and foreign, and it's what would be known as collusion in another term.
So given collusion in another term, but is it surprising to you that he is focusing on things, John, that happened after the administration was in place instead of before the election when there was some sort of collusion? Because, I mean, that would, I mean, it does fall into the scope, but it appears that he's focusing on.
Yellow. Green. Pink. Orange. Thank you. Green. Orange. Yellow. Green. Pink.